see your faces this morning. Glenn, I don't see your face, but it's good to see you. I received a newsletter yesterday in the mail from a missionary that my wife and I support. I'm not going to give you his name. But his newsletter began with these words. It has been a year since the whole world was changed by the COVID pandemic. And, you know, about a year ago, I was on my way back from the Dominican Republic. In fact, we were wondering if we were going to be able to get back. But this whole situation got its start at that time. But as I was reading that sentence, I was a little troubled, and I'm not going to fault my brother who serves the Lord so faithfully, but to say that this changed the whole world is giving way too much credit to a sickness that I realize has caused the death and changed lives of many individuals. But I reminded myself that all illness and everything that can go wrong and death itself is the result of man's sin. We read a few weeks back that as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and so death has passed upon all men. That's worse than the results of any pandemic. And I'm not diminishing how serious this situation is. But in the reality of changing the whole world, there is only one thing that has changed the whole world. And that is the coming of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to these words. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You want to talk about changing the world? Let's talk about Jesus. And I refuse to give honor and glory. I believe in respect, and I believe in carefulness and caution and all of those things that we're doing here, the social distancing, the masks, the washing of our hands, and all of the other things. But when it comes to life-changing and world-changing issues, we give place to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to lift a verse out of its context from Luke chapter 14 and verse 9. And it had to do with places of honor at a wedding feast. And we've got a wedding coming up here in not too awful long. But places and situations and seatings of honor. And a more honorable guest arrives at the wedding, and the word there is, give this man place. This morning, we're going to give Jesus his rightful place, and we're going to honor him. This is Palm Sunday, and if you didn't receive a little palm leaf fashioned into the shape of a cross, make sure to get one to take with you. But this is the Sunday where Jesus, by right and by honor, had every reason to enter into the city of Jerusalem with pomp and circumstance. And wonderfully, the children's voices shouted out their loud hosannas, and yet the people of the city, they were concocting ideas of how to put him to death and to remove him from the honor and glory that is rightfully his. Well, this morning we're going to do that. Welcome to Kalamazoo Chinese Christian Church. We trust that your Palm Sunday is a time for celebration of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We are not a democracy here at KCCC. We are a theocracy. We give God the place of King And this morning we want to honor him with a couple of songs of praise. First of all, to God be the glory.
I'll pray the word.
Let's speak to God in prayer. Father in heaven, we're thankful this morning for the opportunity to give Jesus his rightful place. We're thankful, our God, that as we're gathered together here, our very purpose in gathering is that we might experience his presence in our midst. He has promised that where two or three are gathered together in his name, he will be with them in their midst. And Lord, this morning we would give him his rightful place. We would ask you that in our own hearts, we would have experienced that wonderful blessedness that comes from receiving him personally. We thank you for the word of God that says, as many as received him, it's to them he gives the power to become the children of God, even to those who believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but born of God. And we thank you for the new life that we have. We realize that once we were on the road to death and destruction, but you've changed our course. You've put us on a new road. You've established our going. You've placed our feet firmly upon a rock. And this morning, we trust in you. And we know that apart from faith in your blessed person, there would be no hope, not only for us, but for all of mankind. And so we give you this morning the glory, and we would say from our very heart, how great thou art for all that you have done for us. And so we bless your holy name and ask that you would bless us as we open your word and as we listen to hear your voice. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn with me, please, to Romans chapter 8. Romans, the 8th chapter. This is our second week in Romans chapter 8, and we're going to actually spend 3 weeks in this chapter. It's a very full chapter. It has a broad subject matter that expands really several different thoughts, and I would like to take time to make sure that we learn and grow from the truth that's conveyed to us in this very special chapter of God's Word. I think that most of us, when we think of Romans chapter 8, we think of that wonderful verse that all things work together for good to them that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And what a great verse. And it entails so much. There's, you know, a lot of people just think that it's saying everything's going to work out all right. That's not what it says. It says all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. So it's very specific. It's a qualified, a very qualified promise to us from the Word of God. We're not going to get there today. We're going to be looking at verses leading up to that. And in fact, as we come together for Easter Sunday, we're going to speak on the risen Christ, but predominantly from how God works in us today by his Holy Spirit. And that's what that verse pertains to, that unseen in our situation, the Spirit of God is working behind the scenes to make our lives what God intended them to be and for all things to work together. We tend to work things out, and sometimes when we do so, there's broken pieces left behind and missing parts laying on the ground. God works things together, and it's wonderful to see that because we've really fallen apart. And so there's good stuff coming. Today we're going to look at our redemption, this wonderful plan that we sang about. And in fact, as we close today, we're going to sing that old hymn, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Somebody paid for you that you might be brought to God and that your life might be changed and that you might have within yourself everlasting life and joy and peace from this wonderful work that God has established on earth. Let's turn to Romans chapter 8 and let's begin at verse 9. Romans 8 and verse 9. It says, "But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God lives in you or dwells in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his." And we pointed out that first of all it says the Spirit of God, and then it says the Spirit of Christ. Verse 10 says, "And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life." The Spirit is alive because of righteousness. "But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, lives in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or make alive your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we're debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh." And I might say it like this: you don't owe the flesh anything. As we've been noticing in weeks past, all your flesh has done is give you trouble. And we find ourselves catering to the desires of the flesh that is driven by the senses that we experience in the human experience. And I have to say to you, that's one of the big reasons why the gospel of Jesus Christ and the hope of not only eternal redemption, but of resurrection, and that after this life, we will be raised again unto glory. I have to have that. And I know that there are other religions that speak of, they say resurrection, but they're speaking of a spiritual experience after this life. And I have to say it with Frank Sinatra: I've got to be me. I enjoy things having to do with taste, sight, sound, smell, all of the true essence of those things that we experience in the human body. And that's what God has designed us for. And wonderfully, in resurrection, we will have new bodies, not affected by sin, new bodies that will last eternally, new bodies that will never experience the negative things of sense and of time. You and I will live forever in the wondrous joy of the Lord, experiencing that life that will be apart from sin and will be our wonderful, and it is, we're going to get there this morning, our wonderful hope that causes us to keep on keeping on and causes us to look to the Lord even in the midst of the greatest despair. What are we looking at here in these opening verses of our portion for consideration today? We're looking at what the Bible defines as the born-again experience. The issue where we are given new life by faith in Jesus Christ, something we've never experienced before, the life that we received the day that we were born, the physical life, the fleshly life, is something that passes away. It's something that, especially as we grow older, we experience the diminishing of this flesh and of our fleshly experience. I know we don't like to talk about it. Death is not something that we sit down with friends and discuss around salsa and chips and a tall, cold glass of our favorite soft drink or whatever it is that we happen to be enjoying. No, we tend to avoid that subject. I don't like it when I get telephone calls from life insurance salesmen. And it's a reminder of the fact that article called death, it stands on the path of every man. It is appointed, the scripture says, unto man once to die, And after this, the judgment. And so we preach the gospel aware of the fact that our sin and the result of that sin, the consequence of our sin, is leading us to that time when this life will be over, but wonderful for those of us who have experienced the new birth. Those of us to whom the Spirit of God has brought new life, we look forward to an eternal day when we will stand in the presence of the Lord and our lives will be from glory to glory. And I had somebody ask me a little while ago, they said, I'm really confused about something in the last two chapters of the Bible. And I thought, okay, you know, what could be confusing there? It's about heaven. And they said, well, you know, these trees that line the river of life. I said, yeah. And by the way, there's something very special about them. They're kind of the fruit of the month club tree. They bear 12 different sorts of fruit in each month of the year. And this person said to me, I didn't think we had a reckoning of time in heaven. Well, apparently we do. There's going to be 12 months. There are going to be these trees that bear a different fruit each month of the year. And he said, but there's another thing that troubles me. It says that the leaves of those trees are for the healing of the nations. And in the new earth, there will be nations. There will be those who have faithfully served the Lord that will govern over those as we serve the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There's going to be some interesting system of government there. But what does it mean, the healing of the nations? We normally connect healing with being sick, and I'm getting better. And I had this ache, or I had this pain, I had this injury, and now by the wonderful godly process of healing, I'm recovered. Well, because of the fact that there is no death, no disease, no issues of ill health, no sickness, none of those things will be in eternal glory. The healing that has to be described, that's defined there in the regard of those leaves on those trees of life for the healing of the nation, just means this: healing is getting better. Okay? And we're going to enter into the glory of God in wonderful shape and in wonderful form without any death or dying or sickness. It's very clear about that. But it's going to get better and better and better and better for us as we go along through the many, many ages of eternity. We're going to experience growth and blessing, and actually eternal life is going to increase and get better and better as it goes along. You see, some people say, I'm not really sure about wanting to live forever, but what if it just kept getting better as you went along? I can go for that. And thankfully, that's what God's Word promises. That's the hope that is ours that we're going to look at a little further down in the chapter this morning. But what we have in verse 9, and I mentioned this before in our sermon last week, that it says, if any have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. It's important for us to examine ourselves. It's important for us to sense within ourselves whether or not there is evidence of the presence of God. Is there something of a change that has taken place in me? I know I had a time when I maybe went forward at a campground meeting, or maybe I felt something when someone was speaking to me about my soul and so forth, but has there been a change in my life? That's a valid question. I had somebody say to me, you know, ever since I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, I've had some struggles. And I said, well, you know, life has struggles. No, he says, I'm not talking about that. He says, I feel that in my life, there's sort of a constant fight. There's a constant battle going on. I feel temptation. I feel myself being drawn to particular behaviors and so forth. And he said, I'm struggling with that. And I said to him, praise God. And he looked at me like I was just another goofy preacher. I said, you praise God for that. Because before you came to Christ, wasn't it such that when sin was offered up to you, wasn't it such that when temptation came your way, you just yielded to the temptation and found yourself constantly going in the direction of sin? And he said, why, yes. I said, what you're experiencing now comes from the presence of the Spirit of God in your soul. And the Spirit of God is pricking your conscience. The Spirit of God is causing you to have a sense, a deepened sense of right and wrong and how you might live in order to please God. I said, thank God for that struggle. If you want to read more about it, read the book of Galatians. It says, and we looked at this earlier in our study, that we're at war. And we're in a battle, the spirit against the flesh and the flesh against the spirit. And thank God for that struggle. Let me just say to you this morning, that's an evidence of the presence of God in your life. I had someone one time say to me, you know, something that's really been kind of neat. He says, I used to shrink back from the idea of going to church, and it bothered me when Christians came over to the house, and I didn't like it when somebody talked to me about things of God and of the Word of God and spiritual issues. And he says, now I love it. I couldn't be happier than having Christian friends drop by and sharing something with me and so forth. That's an evidence of the presence of God. You love his people now. You didn't used to. How about the Bible? Do you remember when you'd pick up a Bible and you'd read words and they just kind of bounced off your eyeballs and it was kind of like, this just doesn't make any sense to me. And now as you pick up the Word of God, you see a connection and you feel coming from the instruction of the Word of God, things that affect you in a positive way that are life-changing and absolutely essential for you in your day-to-day experience to get along. And what are you doing there? You're enjoying the Word, and not only that, you're being blessed by the Word of God working within your heart and making life better than it's ever been before. If you don't have that going on in your life, there's something wrong with you spiritually. If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he doesn't belong. But if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead lives in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall make your mortal bodies alive. This is to be expected. Look for this in your experience. And find working within you the very power of God that was used in raising Jesus from the dead. And thank God for the wonderful change that's been wrought in your life since Jesus came into your heart. That's salvation. The Bible calls it the redemption of our spirit. Because until that took place, until the Spirit of God engendered new life into you, you were, as it says in Ephesians, dead in trespasses and in sins. These portions of Scripture, I could take you to numerous places of Scripture where you would see this very same truth explained, perhaps using different words or a different example. John deals with the subject of being born again. Ephesians says he's made you alive. You were dead in trespasses and in sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. That's the devil, by the way. It's really too good of a name for him. The spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our way of life in times past, living in the lust of the flesh, living in the things that were destroying us, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature the children of wrath, just like everybody else. We fit right in with the crew that was on its way to hell, and there we would have gone, except that the Spirit of God drew our attention to the life-saving words of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we said yes to Jesus, and God changed everything that there is to be changed. He gave us new life. He put us on a new road. He gave us new desires. He strengthened our heart that we might experience and have a desire for those things that lead to life and glory, not those things that lead to death and destruction. And now, being born again, not of corruptible seed, as Peter says. Hey, I'm telling you, Paul says it, John says it, Peter says it, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God that lives and abides forever. This stuff fits. And the more you read your Bible, the more you're going to say, haven't I seen this before? Yeah, Peter said it too. James goes into detail. Jude, the word of God given to each of the apostles, they were communicating the same gospel, the same life-giving, life-changing message that we're preaching here this morning. And wonderfully, those of us who have come to Christ, those of us who have had that change, okay, repentance, we've made a change in the way we think. We've made a change in the direction that we're going. We have turned from our sins to God and received His Son. And as many as received Him, it's to them He gives the authority or the right to call themselves the children of God, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but born of God. This morning, if you've accepted Jesus Christ, you have the life of God dwelling in your heart by faith. Verse 12. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. You don't owe your flesh anything. It's done nothing to give you grief. For if you live after the flesh, you're going to die. We had that in chapter 6. But if you, through the Spirit, put to death, mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. And might I say to you this morning, regardless of what's going on around us in the world, we walk by faith, not by fear. I know that's a little different take on that verse. We walk by faith, not by sight. But we don't live in fear. God hasn't called us to fear. I've got a windshield here in front of me this morning. When I come down from here, I'll put on a mask. I'll stay 6 foot away from here, or 3 foot. They changed that a couple of weeks ago. But I'm not living in fear. I'm being careful because of the fact that I'm concerned about you just as I hope you're concerned about me as well. We need to protect ourselves from things that are going on around us. But we don't fear those things. We don't live in a situation of unrest and fear and finding ourselves changing everything that we do and our issues of life because of an unseen enemy that we've termed a virus. We live by faith, and I believe that God is going to get us through this. And I believe that just as in every disease and in every illness, there are those who are affected by it, some even who die, that in reality, that doesn't change anything for us. We live by the faith of the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. And I stand strong in that faith this morning. We have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but we've received the spirit of adoption that causes us to have access to the Father in heaven and call him Daddy. That's what Abba means. I talked to a friend of mine who knows Greek. In fact, he's from Greece. And I said to him, what's the significance of Abba? He says, well, he says, that's the first word that an infant Greek says. And he says, Greek daddies just love this because when the little baby's going, Abba, 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 the daddy smiles a big smile and says, he's saying my name. Abba. It's what a little child would cry out as they're running up the driveway with an all-A report card. It's what a child would cry when they've fallen down on the cement sidewalk and skinned their knee. Abba! It's the most precious form of addressing the Father that human lips can utter. In you and I, because of new birth and this wonder of adoption into the family of God and into his blessedness, we are able to approach the very throne of God and say, that's my dad. And I'm not being disrespectful in saying that. That's how close you and I have been brought to the Heavenly Father. Well, might we pray our Father, our Heavenly Father, our Father which art in heaven. Well, might we come to God in those terms of endearment and approach him, understanding our position and our place in Christ. Oh, I almost forgot. I used to be afraid of God. I used to fear the time when I would appear before him and look upon him as a judge and have a sense of my guilt and of my sinfulness. Ah, I love what's happened since Jesus. I like those words, to be so completely guilty and given over to despair, to look into your judge's face and see a Savior there. And because of that, you and I look into the face of Almighty God and we say, Abba. Abba, Father. The Spirit itself, and I checked this out and it's for some reason neuter, bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. I have to tell you about something that happened to me. This was years ago. I was sitting in a little gospel tent south of the little village of Ceresco, where I currently live. And it was in that little gospel tent before the service even started that I was pondering scripture and struggling with doubts and fears in my own little heart. And a verse of scripture that I learned as a four-year-old child from Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 5 came to me, and it came to me just like this. I've tried everything. I've tried believing. I've tried to trust. I've tried to exercise faith. I've tried prayer. I've read my Bible. I've tried. And these words came to my heart, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We've turned each of us to our own way. And the Lord God has laid on him, the Lord Jesus, all of our iniquity. And you know, those words were written for 3,500, 4,000 years ago, and they could have had my name written there personally. Because I realized that day that he was wounded for David Mason's transgressions. He was bruised, he was crushed for David Mason's iniquities. The punishment for the peace that David Mason needed was poured out upon him. And by his wounds, David Mason was healed. And boy, I got up from the chair I was sitting in. And somebody said to me, "Well, what was it that you were feeling? I said, I don't know what I was feeling, but it felt awfully good. I wasn't struck by a lightning bolt. I didn't have a tingle go up my back. I had a sense of peace with God and forgiveness of sins because of those two ancient verses found in the Gospel of Isaiah, chapter 53. And I realized Jesus died for me. And you know, as I got up from my chair, I was pondering these things in my head, perhaps in my heart. And the thought came to me, well, tomorrow you'll probably just be back where you were, full of doubt and fear, and you'll be having these questions that cause you unrest. And it came to me like this: who would I doubt? Why would I fear? What would I question? And I sat back down and I experienced the wonderful peace that can only come from faith in Jesus Christ. And I said these words: I'm saved. And verse 16 came to my mind. I had learned it as a child. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And I'm telling you, what a wonderful change in my life took place. And you can have that same peace in your heart today. It only comes from knowing Jesus. It's a life-changing, it's an experience that cannot be obtained anywhere else. And it begins you looking at yourself and everything in your regard through a different set of eyes, through a different perspective. So the moment we come to Christ, our spirit comes alive. The moment we receive Jesus as our Savior, we have new birth. We have everlasting life. We have peace with God. We have joy in our hearts. And we're off on a new journey. And that journey involves you and me looking at every issue of life differently because now God is in it. And we begin to experience a change in how we think. We're going to see that when we come to chapter 12, by the renewing of our mind. We looked at it as we were studying the issue of addiction, and that there's a need because everything that we do begins with a thought. A need for our thoughts to change. A need for our emotions, the things that we get excited about, to be changed. The decisions that we make because of our emotion that result in ultimately a consequence. And we begin to experience this ongoing deliverance day by day in our lives as we turn things over to the person of Jesus Christ. And this is a process. Our salvation happened the moment that we believe. The redemption of our spirit happened the moment that new life came into our hearts. But the redemption of our soul, that issue with our lifestyle, our thoughts, our behaviors, and everything else about us being conformed to the image of Christ, and day by day we experience this wonder of, I'm beginning to follow, and I'm beginning to be like Jesus. And the Spirit of God dwelling within our hearts by faith makes changes within us that affect us on the outside, life-changing results as our soul is being redeemed and brought back to God. It's not something that happens immediately. It's not instantaneous like salvation or the moment that we believe. That's something that is a life-giving experience that, my goodness, it's a wonder that takes place in a moment. But this is a process whereby the Spirit of God affects us day by day, moment by moment, step by step, incident by incident, and ultimately we find ourselves being more and more like the one who redeemed us back to God by His blood. Only we're experiencing here the power of the resurrected Christ at work in our lives. Where does this go? Well, we're children of God. Verse 17 says that if we're children, then we're inheritors. We're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And it's wonderful to know that this inheritance, that Jesus has inherited all things from the Father. We are joint inheritors with Him. All that is His is ours. If so be that we suffer with Him, that we may be also glorified together. There are those times when we as Christians experience matters of this world attacking us, matters of other individuals finding fault and making accusations against us because they don't understand who it is that we are or what it is that we have. Sometimes even the people of God can affect us and can attack us and bring difficulties our way. But wonderfully, I can tell you this, that the trials of this daily life are not to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us when Jesus comes. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waits for the day that the sons of God will be revealed. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. By the way, this situation that you and I experience of vanity in our day-to-day living isn't something we signed up for. Any more than you and I may have signed up as to where we would be born, how long we would live, what color our skin might be, or whatever. We didn't fill out an application. I mean, there's things in life that we do have a choice in. But those are the things that happen to us because of who we are and where we are at in God's plans. Remember that verse that says, He has made of one blood all ethnic humanity and has established ahead of time where they would live and when? I struggle with all this talk about racism today because in my Bible, you know, I only find two families that are listed amongst the family of mankind. And one is the sons of Adam by fleshly birth. The other is sons of God by faith in Jesus Christ. We'll see that when we come to chapter 9. We are the children of that promise. And all the rest of the stuff that you and I see going on in the world around us that wrecks Virtually every society is fixed in the church of God. The church of God is God's social order. It's where we come to learn how to live as God would have us to live and to see others through His eyes and give them that calling of God that says He's made man in His own image and in His own likeness and desire them to lead them to a saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. That takes care of all these social programs that the government spends billions on. And as the body of Christ, we see all who come to Him by faith as members one of another and as one body in Christ. That takes care. Some people have said to me, well, you're in a multi-ethnic church. No, I'm in a church that has more than one language. It's a multilingual church. Today, we are children of God through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, and we are one nation. We are one body made up of every people, every kindred, every tongue, to the glory of God. Who subjected us to vanity? I'm going to say it was Adam. He subjected us to vanity, and we were born into this world as sinners, and we had nothing to do with that, but the one who subjected us to vanity is the one who also has subjected us to hope. Because God gave a promise to Adam that by the seed of the woman, there would become a redeemer who would enter into this world and redeem fallen man back to God by his own death. And I have a fallen nature because of my father Adam, but I also have a hope of glory because of the promise that God made to him after that terrible fall. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and struggles. They travail. It's the birth pains. They travail in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption. This is the next step. This is the redemption of the body. Even the redemption of our body. I want you to know that the salvation that you possess sitting here in your seat today at the Kalamazoo Chinese Christian Church is a redemption that involves you in the redemption of your spirit. When you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, it is a redemption that is affecting you today as you struggle and as you desire to live for God and you watch Him make changes in your day-to-day experience. But there's also redemption of the body. And there is a glorious day coming when our frail flesh, when our dying carcasses that connect us to human life will be changed to be glorious, even as His own most glorious body, and we will enter into the presence of the Lord. That's what it means in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and 23, where the Apostle Paul says, "And I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ." If you read that in the Greek, it says the whole spirit of you and soul of you and body of you be preserved blameless. That's our hope that we have this morning. That takes care of so many problems. If we understand that God has addressed our fallen condition in three wondrous aspects of redemption, He has redeemed our spirits with new life. He has redeemed our souls back to Him with the power of His Spirit dwelling within us. And he's given us a hope of eternal glory that these frail frames of human flesh will enter into glory to be with him and to be like him for all eternity. I know there's an Arminian view and there's a Calvinist view. If you just recognize that your redemption is in three parts, all those difficult verses make sense. God didn't give us those verses to argue about. He gave them to us so that we would recognize, wow, I have life. I have new life. Wow, I'm growing. Wow, I have an eternal hope laid up for me in glory. And we live in the light of that wonder of a complete redemption. What a wonderful redemption. Never can a mortal know how my sins, though red like crimson, can be whiter than the snow. And it's much more than that. There is laid up for me in glory an experience that will never end of this new life that is in Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the wondrous salvation that is ours. We thank you for these lives that you've given us to live. We thank you for the hope of eternal glory and a life where we shall dwell forever with you, and it's going to get better and better and better. Not that we will be sick, but that this joy will increase eternally and infinitely, even like yourself. And so, Father, as we cry out to you today and say, Abba, Father, we thank you that we can also pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and look forward to that day when we will hear the shout and be caught up to be forever with our Lord and to dwell in his wondrous presence, to go out no more. We give you our thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.